You know, once upon a time, the UFC used to brand their pay-per-views with these catchy slogans. We had UFC 73, stacked, UFC 78, validation, just a couple of examples. They've done away with that, but I'd like to suggest that they bring it back for UFC 216 and call it UFC 216, almost deja vu all over again, because that's what it felt like earlier today. I'll get to that point in a second, but first, let me say hello to everyone. This is the UFC 216, almost deja vu all over again, MMAfighting.com preview. I'm Ariel Helwani. That is Sean Alshadi. Once again, we're standing outside the T-Mobile Arena here in Las Vegas, Nevada, and Sean, I say almost deja vu all over again because we were at the official weigh-ins earlier this morning, and it felt like UFC 209. Tony Ferguson weighs in, and then we're sitting and waiting for his opponent, and his opponent isn't showing up, and waiting and waiting and waiting, and then at exactly 11 a.m. Pacific time, Kevin Lee emerges, and he steps on the scale, and he's confident he's gonna make 155, and he doesn't make 155. He makes 156, but then Bob Bennett of the Nevada Athletic Commission tells us he has an extra hour. Why? Because he's under 2 pounds as far as the amount of weight he needs to cut, and he's gonna go back and try to make that weight after the Nevada Athletic Commission doctors cleared him, said that he's healthy enough to make that weight. A bizarre scene. So unlike 209, where Khabib Nurmagomedov didn't step on the scale and didn't make weight, that's why it's almost deja vu all over again.
It's catchy.
In the end, Kevin Lee makes the weight. But what a bizarre and somewhat familiar set of circumstances for Tony Ferguson, right?
I mean, it really felt like Groundhog's Day. The mood in that room was so bizarre. And in general, I said it a little bit during the weigh-in stream, but this sport is so bizarre at times where the fact that we can have more drama on weigh-in day where we're just waiting to see, you know, people in their underwear flexing on a scale than the actual day of the event, than the actual day of the sporting contest, the fight. There's something completely wrong with that, just on a fundamental level. But you're right. I mean, I feel like by the time it was about 10:30, and we're getting towards that 30-minute mark, and then it's 20 minutes, 10 minutes, and it's just beginning to feel like there's no way this can happen again. There's no way. And when Kevin Lee weighed in, I don't think anybody in that room was aware of that rule. That's apparently been a rule that's been able to be in effect since the beginning of all of this, since the beginning of all the early weigh-ins. It was a rule. It's an old rule from before the early weigh-ins. But the UFC is at the UFC's discretion to use it, which brings up broader questions of, you know, you got guys like Johnny Hendricks who missed weight by a quarter of a pound in Las Vegas, and they didn't use it then.
Well, I think it's Nevada's discretion.
That's what I mean. In this state,
exactly.
For UFC 200.
Yeah.
And so at that point, when Kevin Lee misses weight, he's 156. He looks surprised. All of us
and
are
depressed.
Stunned. Yeah, all of us are stunned. And it genuinely felt like no one knew that that was even an option.
Yeah.
And we were all flying by the seat of our pants. It was an utterly bizarre scene, and it felt so familiar.
And a lot of people were asking me what would have happened if Kevin Lee missed weight. Well, if he would have made it to the fight, it just would have been a title fight for Tony Ferguson.
Yeah.
Same situation as UFC 206 when Anthony Pettis missed weight. Max Holloway ended up fighting for the belt and ultimately winning the belt. So the fight wouldn't have been canceled necessarily, but Lee couldn't fight for the belt and become the interim lightweight champion. In the end, he makes the weight, and just, you know, a little over 24 hours ago, he's telling us, I weigh 174, and it didn't seem like he had a worry in the world. He also joked about the fact that he had tiramisu on Wednesday. We don't know if that's an actual fact or if he was just trying to make fun of Khabib Nurmagomedov, but that joke did not age well.
No.
What do you make of the way Lee handled this and the way he ultimately looked on Friday morning on the scale?
I mean, he is very, very fortunate, I'll say that, because if he would have missed weight, if it would have been 156 and they don't grant him that extra hour, the fallout from that would have been unlike anything we've ever seen in terms of somebody missing weight. I mean, people give Johnny Hendricks a hard time when he misses all these different times, and, you know, various other people, Ray Borg felt it a little bit. But the confidence with which Lee was almost bragging and prodding the fact that he was so high on Wednesday at this point, Thursday, and then he comes in on Friday, and that if that would have happened, it would have been unreal. He would have never, ever let it. It would have followed him for the rest of his career.
Did you have a certain idea in your mind as to how this fight was going to play out, and did today's events change your opinion on the fight?
I mean, it certainly changed my opinion in general. I mean, I felt one way about this fight, and now I feel more strongly about that. Just on the sole fact that, I mean, we saw Kevin Lee in there. He looked awful. He looked miserable. He probably should have missed weight. So the fact that he got to that point, how much can his body really bounce back from that within a 24-hour span? I mean, 19 pounds in that small of a time frame is so It's just, it, I mean, I know guys.
Unimaginable, yeah.
I know guys have done more, but that doesn't make it any better, you know? Like, and that has to affect your performance in some fashion. Like, it has to be much harder to bounce back from that than whatever, you know, a normal
sure.
outcome.
And my impression is his team didn't know until just a couple of minutes before, and then they're informed, and then they go on the scale, and then they say, all right, let's just get this over with the first step, so then we could go back and try to cut that extra pound. And so, based on your response, I'm getting the impression that initially you thought Tony Ferguson was going to win, and now you're just a little more confident that he's going to win. Is that accurate?
Yeah, that's accurate. I mean, if we look back at UFC 209 when we were here, it was going to be Tony and Khabib. I was saying that whole week I felt like Tony was going to win. I feel like Tony's been the best lightweight in the world for a while now. I'm fully aboard the Tony bandwagon, and I coming into this fight, there was a little bit of iffiness on it because, I mean, Kevin Lee has looked so good, and he is so young and promising, and he's so talented at such a young age. But I think now, just considering in light of what we've seen, I feel more strongly and more confident in the fact that Tony will become victorious.
And speaking of that bandwagon, and I know you've been firmly on at the Tony bandwagon, I must say that he feels a lot more comfortable in his own skin this week. Like, even at the ceremonial weigh-in, listening to music, dancing, not really getting involved in the jawing back and forth with Kevin Lee. In the past, it has felt like he tries too hard, but I don't know if it's being here on Sunday and just his perspective changing, but it feels like a different Tony Ferguson. More mature, more confident, just more sure of himself. Do you get that impression as well?
Absolutely. I mean, if you just even look back to the videos that we took last week with the media lunch with him and Verdum, and kind of the way that he was answering questions within the media and just acting in general. And then you look at how he was acting on media day this week, is night and day. It's a completely different person. And it really felt, just talking to him a little bit on media day, that he was shook by what happened this weekend, and understandably so. And in that situation, something like that can really put in perspective, you know, what's really important in life, and kind of make somebody reassess how they're acting. And perhaps that happened with him. But I agree. I mean, he has really seemed to come into his own this week, just in whatever kind of character he is.
Yeah.
Like, it's not, I don't even want to say character, because it's not. It seems like that's actually authentically who he is, and he has become supremely confident with just in whatever that is, in doing his own thing and not worrying about, you know, what everybody else thinks about
it. He's embracing his uniqueness, his sort of weirdness, and it's a nice weirdness. In the past, it was kind of a cringeworthy weirdness. That's how I took it, and I know a lot of other people shared my feelings, but it feels different this week. Now, it's interesting. We talked about Kevin Lee kind of being this budding superstar and felt like he was maybe on the verge of great things. And a journalist named Oscar Willis, who works for the MacLife, I thought brought up a great point at the end of the weigh-ins. He mentioned how, you know, Conor's watching this fight, and Kevin just having trouble making weight, even with a win on Saturday, almost excludes him from the lottery, you know, the race to get that lottery ticket, right? Do you feel like he's almost done too much damage now? Because Conor has said this many times before, I don't want to play with Khabib because he's too, you know, he's too much of a wild card. Now we see what happened with Kevin Lee. Do you feel like this is going to ultimately do a lot of damage, even if he wins on Saturday?
I mean, that's an interesting question, and it's something I haven't really thought about. There's a chance, because you're right, Conor does, he thinks about all
of
this.
He wants someone who's going to show up because he's been burned before.
But that being said, it's I think it's too early to say that. Okay. Because if Kevin Lee goes out there tomorrow and knocks out Tony Ferguson in the first round and cuts an insane promo just looking at the camera, talking to Conor, I mean, I feel like that wipes away a lot.
Okay. So how does Tony do it?
You know what? I think, honestly, if this fight was 2 years from now, maybe my opinion would change. I think it's just a little too much too soon for Kevin Lee. And I don't even... Maybe that's the wrong words, because he's been in this division for so long at this point. He's almost a veteran in this division. He's over 10 fights in this division. I think he's just too young in kind of his maturation as a fighter. The peak Kevin Lee is still several years away from now. And I think Tony Ferguson right now has hit his stride on such a fundamental level on all cylinders. I think ultimately Tony's going to kind of wear him down. Kevin Lee's biggest, strongest suit is his back takes. You know, his wrestling is very good, but his back takes are excellent. And Tony just never lets himself get his back even get open. Like, he never lets his back become available. He does all these crazy rolls and angles and movements. And I just feel like he's not going to let Kevin... He's the best pressure fighter in the division by such an insane margin. Like, when Rafael dos Anjos was the lightweight champion, just crushed guys with crazy pressure. When Tony Ferguson, if you rewatch the fight with Tony Ferguson and RDA, Tony Ferguson just does not give RDA an inch the entire fight. He out-pressured one of the best pressure fighters of, you know, we've ever seen at lightweight. I feel like he's just going to be too much, and he's going to overwhelm Kevin Lee, and you know, it may, at some point the weight cut may come in. Maybe Kevin Lee starts to fade.
Yeah.
I'm seeing maybe a third round, fourth round Darce choke. Take okay. him to Snapdown City.
I love it. Speaking of that weight cut, by the way, I mentioned earlier today that I feel like we're just, you know, dangerously coming close to that point where there's going to be a serious injury or maybe even a death. And we've had this before as far as weight cuts are concerned, but never on a big stage like the UFC. And I feel like it's just high time that we change the weight classes, that we go 155, 165, 175, 185. Now, is that the lone solution to fixing this problem? No, but it is
it's
the quickest.
First step.
Yes, and it's the quickest and it's the cheapest. If you want to really like change weight cutting and put in new rules and regulations, that costs a lot of money, and there's a lot of red tape as far as the commissions and the government is concerned, because that's who ultimately oversees each state, right? And so I'm surprised at some of the backlash to that idea, because here's a guy like Kevin Lee who had trouble today, who has openly said, if there's a 165-pound division, I'm the first guy there. And I think that if there are just more options, guys are not going to feel the need to cut that much weight and go from, you know, walking around at 175 to 155. And oh, by the way, the UFC is clearly in need of more titles because they keep making interim title fights.
Yeah.
So now you have more reasons to have title fights, potentially new stars who are the kings of these divisions. Why don't they do this? Do you have any idea? Could you think of any idea why they just don't open it up finally? And it makes everything easier, in my opinion.
It's funny, man, because, again, if you look back at what our coverage for UFC 209, we had this exact same conversation.
Did we really?
In the exact same spot, right after the weigh-ins, after the whole thing happened with Khabib. You're right, it's not a solution, but it's a fantastic first step. The gap we have established at this point, the gap between 155 and 170 is just too wide.
170, 185, 185, 205.
But even just within 155 and 170, those are easily the two deepest divisions in this entire sport. There is more than enough talent to split that up. If you just kept 155, take the champion of 170, say you can either be the champion of 165, 175, your choice, whatever you want, give Tyron Woodley the option, and then just make the other division, you would see so many guys just flooding to that new opportunity, and it would create such an interesting kind of arms race in a way, because you're right, there's so many different scenarios that you could then start throwing out. That's another belt for Conor to go to, the 165. There's all these different like multi-division people that could kind of switch back and forth. Khabib would be a perfect 165er. You know, you have 70 smaller 70ers could drop out, because at this point, 155 seems like a lot of welterweights that just are too short to actually be welterweights, because a lot of the welterweights are huge, huge men.
Yeah.
They're not people who walk around even close to 170.
And so, by the way, you're only adding two new weight classes, because 170 becomes 175, so that's not really a new one. You're adding 165 and 195. That's it.
Yeah.
You're only adding.
You're adding 160. Oh yeah, yeah.
165, 195. It's only two new weight classes. So instead of doing these interim title fights, and you know you have this need to headline pay-per-views with title fights, just do that. And I feel like it would really open things up and give the fighters more options. So anyhow, we're not going to change it today, but it just feels like we always come dangerously close to that line. Let's talk about the co-main event now.
Sure.
Let's talk about Demetrius Johnson versus Ray Borg. DJ is one win away from breaking Anderson Silva's record. He would become the most successful champion in UFC history, his 11th title defense. And we were supposed to see this fight last month. We've had a lot of time to digest this fight. It seems like DJ himself is kind of over the whole thing and just wants to get on
Very
with his life.
So.
Do you see any scenario in which Ray Borg can shock the world here?
You never want to say never. I mean, it's a fight. Anything can happen. I don't see it. I think of the 10 title defenses that have sort of been in Demetrius Johnson's reign, this would be one of the more unlikely upsets among those 10. I think aside from a Chris Carriasso or something, this would be one of the most shocking among those 10 opponents.
So you're not really high on Ray Borg at all as far as his chances going into this fight?
I mean, I'm very high on Ray Borg.
But his chances?
Yeah.
Stacking him up against DJ?
I think this is, again, a Kevin Lee type of situation where it's just a little bit too soon for him. I mean, he's a very talented prospect in the sport, but he's still also a prospect. He's a young guy. And we've kind of seen this a lot at flyweight. Kyoji Horiguchi, some of these guys just getting forced into these shots really soon. It might happen
Henry
with
Cejudo.
It might happen with Sergio Pettis soon now, too. I just feel like I feel supremely confident in saying that DJ is going to win this fight. And no disrespect to Ray Borg, because he's an amazing fighter.
You think he does it early?
Yeah, I could see like a second round something, submission.
So if he does break that record, where do you put DJ in the pantheon
That's
of great
hard,
fighters?
Man. That's hard, man, because it's just, if you had asked this 3 months ago, I feel like we all kind of had an understanding, a collective understanding that it's John Jones and then everybody else. And now what do you do with that, right?
Yeah.
if someone fails for a PED test, and this is actually a question I've been kind of battling with myself, and I'll have a piece out about this. If somebody fails a PED test within their career, should that disqualify them from the GOAT conversation? Because Anderson's out then. John Jones is out then. Who's left? I mean, you have George St. Pierre, you have DJ, maybe like Fedor. But I don't know who I would put among them in that point. I think DJ is in that spot already. I think he's on that kind of Mount Rushmore of all-time greats. But I wouldn't put it, even if he wins today, I just wouldn't. I don't know what it is preventing me from putting him on that kind of upper number one platform, but I just still can't do it.
He's a victim of his competition, right? Yeah. I mean, like, he just hasn't had the opportunity to fight the very best in this game. That's no fault of his own, but those are the facts.
Yeah.
These fighters wouldn't, you can't stack them up against the guys GSP or Anderson Silva fought, and that's no knock on DJ, but that's just what he's had to deal with.
Yeah, you're right.
And so it's hard to really truly gauge where he would be. I totally agree with you.
When he started, the division was in its absolute infancy. Like, flyweight had existed, but it hadn't really existed. It existed in regional shows where guys were fighting for peanuts, basically, and so there was no real incentive to be a flyweight, and if you were that small of a man, there was no reason to come into the sport.
Right.
So it's still developing. I mean, you even see now with Henry Cejudo's last performance, it looked like a completely different fighter than the one who fought DJ. Yeah. Like, I would be interested in seeing that now, but we've already seen it once, so it's kind of, the whole thing is strange. But DJ is more or less a victim of circumstance, which is unfortunate, because you just talk to fighters, like I talked to a lot of the fighters at Media Day this week, and they just feel like he's underrated among themselves. Like, not even with the fans and the media, just amongst fighters underrate him. Like, Benil Dariush said one thing to me where he's just like, I don't even know if we know how good DJ is. And part of that's true, because I don't know that we've ever really seen him pushed. Like, you got a John Jones, DC, right?
Yeah.
Anderson Chael. These guys have these rivalries, these things that, these people, individuals that push them to a higher plane of greatness. DJ's just never even had to be in that spot, and that's no fault of his own at all.
Seems to me like he'll be one of those guys, one of those fighters, champions, who will only truly be appreciated once he's gone.
Yeah.
Looking back, I think his career will look better, will age better than the way he's appreciated and talked about now.
Absolutely, and I do want to say one point, which is, I think one of the biggest check marks he does have on kind of, if you want to throw him into kind of this greatest of all time conversation, is the man's record is completely unblemished just on a personal side. There's no PED issues, there's no arrests, there's not a single issue you can point to along his, you know, decade-long career where you point to and say he messed up.
Yeah.
And that's got to count for something.
Yeah. Well said. Let me ask you about the Derek Lewis Fabricio Werdum fight. It's an important fight at heavyweight. It's an important fight for both men. I would venture to guess that the UFC has a little more invested in Derek Lewis right now just because he's a fresher face. Werdum has had his time as champion, bit of a rocky relationship with the UFC. Do you like this matchup for Derek Lewis coming off the loss to Mark Hunt, coming off the injury, coming off the retirement, considering everything he's been through over the past month and a half or so back home in Houston? Is Werdum too much of a step up? Does it not really make sense for him? I've kind of struggled with this one a little bit, even though he looks to be in great shape and appears very motivated for this fight.
I mean, I like the fight itself, and it's a really good example of just kind of how unique heavyweight is, right?
Yeah.
Where it's just, no matter how you lose, one big win could get you right back in there. If Derek Lewis goes in there and smokes Fabricio Werdum, we're talking about him among, you know, an Overeem, Ngannou type of like situation in that same reign. But I like the fight for him. I'm just more concerned about what he's had to go through at this point. Of the stage of, you know, the lead up to this fight, like, he's had to deal with so much that we haven't even seen. I mean, he's given us privy to a little bit of kind of what he's dealing with in Houston, but even just asking him about it, he's still, you know, things are really messed up there still. Like, the world's kind of moved on because we've had tragedy after tragedy, very unfortunately, but Houston is still, you know, dealing and reeling with this, and people in his life are still dealing with this, and that's a difficult place to go into a fight like this, whereas it is such an important fight for him to be able to bounce back among that, right?
Your pick?
You know what? I've gone back and forth on this one more than any of the fights for this week. Part of me wonders, just because Fabricio Werdum is 40 at this, and I feel like when we saw him kind of elevate himself into UFC champion, and he beat Kane, and he was kind of started to become talked about within that all-time heavyweight conversation, he was always getting better in those fights. Each fight you saw him, he was getting better and getting better. Since that title reign, I feel like he's just gotten worse in every fight. Like, he seems to be on that decline. I mean, he's beaten Travis Brown only within the last 2 years. That's his only win in the last 2 years. I mean, the Overeem fight was obviously a close one and a controversial one, but part of me, I just have a gut feeling. I'm going to say Derek Lewis.
Okay, Derek Lewis. Wow, does he get a knockout?
No, I think it's going to be a decision, but I can't tell where Verdum is at this point in his career. It's very difficult.
Yep. I hear you. Before I let you go, there's some fights, you know, interesting ones littered throughout this card. Worth noting, by the way, that we started the day with 13 fights on this card. We now have 12 because Nick Lentz never made weight, and his fight against Will Brooks was canceled. Will Brooks very upset about that, understandably so, and that was a great fight in the lightweight division. But is there any other fight before we go that you want to spotlight that you're really looking forward to tomorrow night?
Absolutely. I mean, Tom Dukinwah is a huge prospect. Yeah. I'm really interested in that fight. Cody Stamann is you know, an excellent fighter in and of himself. That's going to be an interesting test to see where Dukinwah is.
Yep. Love that fight. 15-1 against 15-1. Two great prospects at 135. Great choice.
Lando Venata taking on Bobby Green. I'm still really high on Lando. He's been. It was interesting to see. It's going to be interesting for me to see kind of how he's able to bounce back from that, because when he came into the UFC and then he had that performance against Tony, and then, you know, his subsequent knockouts, people got so excited about him, and you could kind of sense within him, like, he was feeling it, he was getting excited about himself. And a loss like that, I feel like that kind of makes you take a step back and reevaluate. Yeah. Maybe I was getting a little too ahead of myself. I'm interested to see how he bounces back. I still think he is a super promising prospect in that division. And altogether, I mean, there are some fun fights, like, littered throughout this card.
Beneil Dariush versus Evan Dunham as well on the pay-per-view main card. That should be a fun one. By the way, we had the UFC 217 press conference earlier. George St. Pierre, Michael Bisping, Yuan Yang Jacek, Rose Namajunas, Cody Garbrandt, TJ Dillashaw. Did you enjoy it? Bit of a small crowd that showed up, understandably so, but Michael Bisping went pretty hard at GSP. What did you think of it overall? What would you grade it?
He went hard in the paint. He was on fire from the beginning. You know, I am one of the few that enjoys this fight in a little. I've kind of always dug this fight. I like the dynamic between them. Bisping is just so relentless and overwhelming with the way he trash talks George. George seems to just get so, like, lost in it and overwhelmed in it. It was entertaining for what it was. I think we kind of, it's hard to, I don't know. It seemed subdued in a way.
Yeah.
But my biggest takeaway from that whole press conference was just the stare down between Joanna and Rose. I mean, the intensity between those two women is just magnificent to watch. I cannot wait for that one.
We're not quite back to normal here in Las Vegas. Slowly but surely, it seems like things are kind of getting back to normal, and hopefully UFC 216 tomorrow night here at the T-Mobile Arena can help begin that healing for this community. The UFC, as we said earlier in the week, has long been the hometown team here before the Golden Knights and the Raiders eventually came to town. So I think this is an important thing for the community, and it's somewhat coincidental that, you know, of all weekends, the UFC is here. They could be anywhere in the world. And so it seems as though they're going to be honoring their hometown city tomorrow night throughout the card, wearing t-shirts that say Vegas Strong. The vibe here is slowly, like I said, getting back to normal. A nice little crowd at the weigh-ins. Looking forward to tomorrow night watching some fun fights. Hopefully it turns out to be a great night for the company, for the fighters, for everyone involved, for the MMA community, and of course, most importantly, for Las Vegas, Nevada as well. We appreciate you watching our coverage up until this point. We'll be back on Saturday night for our usual fight night coverage. Enjoy the fights. We'll see you afterwards. Talk to you on Saturday night.